Thank you, everybody. Praise the Lord. This morning I'm about to preach on, are you a disciple? Are you a disciple? You know, it's so easy to come to church regularly, as a matter of fact. Or maybe to even give your life to Christ. You answer the altar call. Or maybe in your bedroom, you give your life to Christ. And that's where it has stopped. But actually, God wants us to be disciples and to make disciples. Not churchgoers. Not baby Christians, not those who say we are Christians, but do not live the life or have the life, but disciples. I will take my text this morning from Luke chapter 14, and I'll read from verse 25 to verse 33. Luke 14, verse 25. To verse, wonderful, 43. It says, now great multitudes went with him, and he turned and said to them, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his father, and mother, wife, and children, brothers, and sisters, yes, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. And whoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not sit down first and count the cost, whether he has enough to finish it? Lest after he has laid the foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. Or what king going to make war against another king does not sit down first and consider whether he is able with 10,000 to meet him who comes against him, or with 20,000? Or else, while the other is still a great way off, he sends a delegation and asks conditions of peace. So likewise, whoever of you does not forsake all that he has cannot be my disciple. Serving God is not just about attending church. It's not just I answer the altar call or I confess Christ in my bedroom or wherever. It's not about I'm in church and I sing in the choir. It's not about I'm in technical or whatever it is that you do in church or for church. But it's about being Jesus' disciple. When Jesus was leaving, he gave a great commission, what we call the Great Commission. Matthew 28, verse 19 and verse 20. We say, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations. And so, God's will for us and for all nations is to make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you, and be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of age. I have read scripture and I have not found a place where God says, go into the world and make churchgoers. I have not read a place where he says, go into the world, bring sinners into the church, but they don't have to do anything. He says, make disciples. Our commandment as the church of Jesus Christ is to make disciples. In our text today, Jesus says three times, cannot be my disciple. And it's so easy for us to consider these very harsh words. It says, if you don't hate father, mother, wife, child, brother, sister, you cannot be my disciple. And I'll go into that later. It says, if you do not carry your cross, you cannot be my disciple. It says, if you don't count the cost, you cannot be my disciple. What does this mean? It means that God has standards. He has standards. He has things that you must be to be his disciple. And so I ask you once again this morning, are you his disciple? Are you a disciple of Jesus Christ? Obviously, we know that before you can be a disciple, you actually have to come. And that's the first part of that scripture. It says, if anyone comes to me, if anyone comes to me. So you have to first of all come to him. You have to first of all give your life to Jesus. You have to first of all come to that place of his grace. You have to first of all come to that place where you make that decision to follow him. To follow him. That place where you confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. That place of belief that he came to die for your sin and was resurrected so we might have life, have eternal life. You have to come to that place of a personal relationship with him, not a relationship through somebody else, pastor, vicar, priest, or reverend, whatever they are called, we are called. But a relationship with Jesus in the real sense of it. Not a very far relationship of the God that is sitting high, far above there that no one can reach, but the God that is right inside you. And the way you relate to people that are close to you is the way you relate to him. You have to, first of all, have done what Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and verse 10 says, that you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the mouth, for with the heart, one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. That if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. You'll be saved. So you have to first of all come. That's come to him. Know him as Lord, as Savior. Know him as your Redeemer. Know him as your God. Believe in him. And believe in the substitutionary work that he did on the cross of Calvary. Now, if you have come to him, if you have come to the Lord, there are three things I want you to think upon this morning. I've already mentioned them in my introduction. Think three things I want you to think about this morning. Think three things you must know, three things you must act upon so that you can actually be a disciple. The first one is obey the great commandment. The first thing I want you to know is that the great commandment comes before the great commission. Without the great commandment, you have no business with the great commission. Jesus says in the first in the our text of today, he says, if you come to me, not hating father, mother, and so on and so forth, for. And somebody will say, what? What is he talking about here? Is Jesus Christ a hater? Is Jesus Christ saying that once you become a Christian, then you have nothing to do with your parents, your wife, your children, your brothers and sisters? And in the past, a few decades ago, we remember that Christians misunderstood the scripture and actually cut away their family members. But what is this scripture actually saying? What is it saying? What is Jesus saying here? Is he negating the fifth commandment that says, honor your father and your mother? Exodus 20 verse 12. Is it contradicting the word of God in Ephesians 5 verse 25 that says, love your wife? Is it contradicting the word of God in 1 Timothy chapter 5 verse 8 that says, if you do not provide for your family, you are an unbeliever? Is that what God is saying here? Absolutely not. That's not what he's saying here. What actually is he saying here? If this scripture is clarified in Matthew chapter 10 verse 37, where he says, we are not to love anyone more than him. He didn't mean you hate your father, you hate your mother, you hate your brother, you hate your sister, neighbors and acquaintances. All he was saying is, we are not to love anyone more than him. The point is that my love for God is the uppermost limit on my love for anyone or anything else. The person I love the most is God. And this is the great commandment. If you read the great commandments in Matthew 22, 37 to 40, Matthew 22, verse 37 to verse 40, maybe I should read verse 40 alone. It says, you shall love the Lord your God. Now, Jesus, let me start from the beginning. Jesus said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And verse 38 says, this is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. So what is it saying? Love God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul. That's what this scripture is saying. So my first question to you this morning, and my first challenge to you, is do you love God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind? Do you love God with conditions? How far does your love for God go? When God decides to intervene or step in particular areas of life, will that love hold, or would you cast him out? When God decides at some point to interrupt your plan, when he decides to interrupt your life, would you go? Would you obey? You have set a plan. I think I should tell you my story. A few years ago, this must be 10 years ago, I was in the second to the highest position you can get in the business I was running. And I made an 18-month plan to get to the highest position. I think I'm in the highest position right now, right? I made an 18-month plan to get to the highest position. I traveled far and wide because I had people in my units from 7 countries. And so I traveled all over. I met with my directors. Well, I was an executive director. I had directors under me. So I met with all my directors in the countries, and we sat down, and we wrote out what we've got to do for the next 18 months to get there. And everybody was fired up, and everybody began to work. And 2 months later, God said, I have a different plan. You're actually going to start a church for me. I said, what? Church? No, you know, God, I intend to do ministry in about 24 months' time. But, you know, when I get to that position, I don't need to work anymore, but I'll be paid for not working. So let me get there first, and then I can do the work. And God says, you're starting a church in Chester in a few months' time. when God interrupts your life, does your love reach that place without love sustain? Or will you say, God, press pause. Let me go for 3 years and come back. God, have mercy. Would you give the excuses that men have given in scripture? Luke chapter 9, verse 59. Somebody said, Lord, let me go and bury my father. In verse 61 of the same chapter, Luke chapter 9, somebody says, but let me go back and say goodbye to my family. Do you love God? Are you obeying the great commandment? Love God with all your heart and love neighbor, your neighbors as yourself. God asked, Jesus asked Peter this question. In John chapter 1, if you read from verse 15 to verse 19, Jesus asked him three times, Peter, do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? This was Peter that had betrayed Jesus. But our God does not think the way we think. At this point, Jesus said, I'm about to send you on the Great Commission, but the first priority is your love for me. Do you love me? It was after Peter said, yes, I love you. He said, okay, feed my sheep. Do you love me? He said, you know I love you. He said, feed my lambs. He said, do you love me? He said, but you know everything. You know that I love you. He said, feed my sheep. So I'm asking you this morning, do you love him with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all you are, with all you have, with all that is within you? Do you love God totally, completely? Do you love God unconditionally? Or do you love God when things are good? And when things are bad, you decide to love yourself. Or you love your brother, or you love your boss, or you love the bank manager. Do you love God unconditionally? Do you love God enough to obey his word when things are tough? Do you love God enough to maintain integrity in the face of persecution? Do you love God enough to maintain integrity when things are not exactly how you expected it to be? Do you love God enough to actually continue to love your wife, take care of your wife when she's misbehaving? Because your love for your wife is dependent on your love for God. Your love for your husband is dependent on your love for God. It is when you can love God completely, you can love your wife. The more you love God, the more you have the ability to love your wife or to love your husband. So the first priority is, do you love God? God help us. Number two, if you look at verse 27, of the scripture that we read this morning, he says, but whoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not bear his cross. So number 2 point is carry your cross. Carry your cross. Salvation is through coming to the cross. Discipleship is through carrying the cross. Are you carrying the cross? Are you taking up your cross? Jesus gives a great example in the Garden of Eden. In Luke 22, verse 41 to verse 42, he says, and he was withdrawn from them about a stone's throw, and he knelt down and prayed, saying, Father, if it is your will, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. When your will crosses God's will, what do you do? I've had a lot of things said in my years of being a Christian about what carrying the cross means. Some people say it is when a Christian has a sickness, he's carrying the cross. Not so. You say when a Christian is suffering, it means you are carrying your cross. I don't know. But I know that when your will crosses God's will, what do you choose? What decisions do you make? That decision you make for God in that situation is carrying your cross. Continuing in the path that God has set, despite contrary evidences and situations around you, is carrying your cross. It is not the situation itself that is the cross. Carrying your cross is despite the sickness, I must do what God has ordained me to do. So when your will crosses God's will, like Jesus' will crossed the Father's will in Luke 22, 41 to 42, and he chose the Father's will, what do you do? You want to get married, and that brother says, unless you sleep with me, for me to know, just to test, I will not marry you. What do you do? No test runs, eh? What do you do? Imagine Jesus Christ God doing test runs every morning to see, should I wake her up, should I not wake her up? Let me give her 5 minutes of oxygen and 5 minutes of light, and then after that we'll see. No test runs. Would you say what Jesus said when you come to that point of decision, that decision place, that not my will, but let your will. Even though some things around me are not cooperating with me, not my will, let your will be done. You are carrying your cross when you cease to make yourself the object of your life and actions. You are carrying your cross when you deny your own agenda to seek God's kingdom, not yours. That is when you are taking up your cross. Paul said in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20 and verse 21, he says, I did not set aside the grace of God. Not to be crucified with Christ is to treat Christ's death as meaningless. I did not set aside the grace of God. Not to be crucified with Christ is to treat Christ's death as meaningless. Do you live in total surrender? We are talking about total surrender here. Do you live in total surrender? Are you sold out to the Lord? Do you keep on going even though it does not make sense? Jesus commanded those who followed him to take up their cross and to follow him. It's not just one-time experience. It's a lifetime experience. It's a cross and not a thorn. We know that Apostle Paul had a thorn. I think that's 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7. The Bible says that he had a thorn so that he would not be proud. The thorn was put there. And so he had no choice. But a cross is something that you decide and you willingly carry. It is a decision, not a thorn. It's a cross, not a thorn. It's a decision that you made. It's not something that is put upon you. So, are you carrying your cross? Crosses are voluntary. Crosses as a result, but thorns are not. It's not something that irritates you. It's a way of life. You must carry the cross continuously. Not one day, not one month, not one year. You carry the cross till we see Jesus. So are you carrying your cross? Or are you sometimes on holiday from carrying the cross? Imagine if Jesus Christ had carried the cross halfway and then told the rulers in those days, let me go for another 3 months and come back to carry it to Golgotha. What do you think would have happened? Or the Garden of Gethsemane, when he got there, and they came and said, let's take you. Say, I surrendered. I'm not even preaching again. Cross, I'm not going. Don't worry. After all, I don't have to. I've not committed anything. What do you think would have happened? So I ask you, are you a disciple? Because a disciple will carry his cross. No matter what you're facing, no matter where you are at in your life right now, no matter the circumstances of your life, no matter the situation you are in, you will carry your cross. You will not deny him. You will carry your cross. Number three. Count the cost. Count the cost. Cost. Verse 28 to verse 33 that we read in the passage, you know, talks about this. It talks about the fact that it says, which of you intending to build a tower does not sit down first and count the cost, whether he has enough to finish? And then he goes ahead and talks about the one that is going to war as well. But do you know that Jesus Christ has counted the cost? Jesus Christ is the builder himself of his church, like the Bible says in Matthew 16, 18. And he's the king. He's a man of war. He knows exactly how much is going to his church was going to cost him. It's going to cost him. He knows what it will take to build his kingdom. There is no math for us to calculate. The bottom line is, if you do not say goodbye to your possessions, you cannot be my disciple. Verse 33. Verse 33 says, so likewise, whoever of you does not forsake all that he has cannot be my disciple. So what the scripture is saying in essence is forsake all. Nothing and no one should be more important. Count the cost. And what does this mean? What it means is that you need to have the attitude of, I don't have to survive. Hello? Tell your neighbor, I don't have to survive. I just have to do his will. I don't have to survive, I just have to do his will. That attitude is seen through scriptures. In Abraham, Genesis chapter 12, God said to him, leave your people and go to a place I will show you. That was an I don't have to survive attitude when Abraham packed his family and began to go. He didn't know where he was going. The Hebrew boys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, in Daniel chapter 3, they had the I don't have to survive attitude. If you look at verse 17 and verse 18, what did they say? They said, we are not going to bow to your golden image. If you like, put us in the fiery furnace. They said, because we know our God will deliver us. But guess what? We don't actually have to survive. What does that mean? What did they say? They said, even if he does not save us, we are not going to bow to your image. I don't have to survive. I just have to do his will. What did Esther say? In Esther chapter 4, verse 16, he says, I'm not supposed to go before the king. If I step into that court and he does not hold out his scepter to me, I'm finished. But then what did she say? She said, if I perish, I perish. I don't have to survive. I just have to do his will. I just have to fulfill my calling. One of the problems that Christians have nowadays is that we are chasing after survival and neglecting the will and the purpose of God for our lives. If you are going to be a disciple, you will have the I don't have to survive attitude. I don't have to survive. I just got to do his will. The widow in Mark chapter 12, verse 41 to verse 44, that we popularly talk about when we are talking about offering. The widow that gave the widow's mite. I saw something in that scripture last night. I was reading the New King James Version. The last statement in that verse 44 says, she gave her whole livelihood. The widow gave her whole livelihood. Not that she gave little out of little, which is what a lot of us have believed over time. She gave her whole livelihood. Meaning what? She gave all. What attitude is that? I don't have to survive. I don't know what I'm going to survive tomorrow, but I'm giving all today because I trust him. It's about his will. It's about what he said. It's not about me. Apostle Paul said in Acts of the Apostles chapter 20 verse 24, he says, but none of these things move me. Nor do I count my life dear to myself, so that I may finish my race with joy and the ministry which I receive from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of his grace. What is he saying here? He says, but none of these things move me, nor do I count my life dear to myself. Meaning what? I don't have to survive. I've just got to finish the race. Are you a disciple? Are you concentrating on the race? Is the race in your view? Or is it God's provision that is in your view? Is it how he will heal me that is in your view? Is it how he will give me a husband that is in your view? Is it how he would give me that business that is in your view? Is it just the benefits that is in your view? Or are you actually thinking about the race? Are you thinking about how you are going to finish the race? Are you thinking about the fact that it does not end here? Are you thinking about the fact that God has a plan? Are you thinking about the fact that you have to finish well? All you need is to obey God. And you trust God enough to know that he's faithful. Have you counted the cost? Part of the cost is that you need to know that you don't have to survive. You've just got to do his will and be in his will. And the last example I wanted to give is Jesus himself. Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 to verse 13. Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 to verse 13. It says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant, and coming in the likeness of men, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, and of those in heaven, and of those on earth, and of those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in us both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Are you a disciple? Have you made yourself of no reputation? Have you decided to continue to resist until death? Apostle Paul said you have not resisted until death. Have you decided to follow through? Not abandon Jesus on the way. There's this common song we used to sing, very, very old song. I don't know whether you sang it in this country, Margaret. Mm-hmm. I have decided to follow Jesus. Mm-hmm. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Have you decided to follow him to the end and not to turn back? Have you decided that come what may, no turning back? If you have, then you are a disciple. Are you a disciple? There's one thing that determines whether you're a disciple or not. One question that I would like you to ask yourself. Have I given up everything for Christ? Have you given up everything for Christ? You don't have to be a pastor, no. You can give up everything and not be a pastor. Have you given up everything for Christ? Are you in control or is he in control? The issue here is total surrender. Are you surrendered? I'd like to call everyone. I want to make a call this morning for people who have reconsidered their lives, their walk with God in the light of this message this morning. I would like some help from heaven. You have seen yourself in the light of the scripture this morning and you want help. You have seen that you have lacked in many ways. Some have seen that they are even backsliding already. You know that you don't have to begin to steal or to kill or to do what the world does before you backslide. Backsliding starts in the heart. Would you like prayers this morning? Please come forward. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You like prayer, please come. Don't be ashamed. If other people are not interested in being disciples, you, what the Lord has said to you, please, it's you and God. Please don't be ashamed. In fact, for those who are sincere, you know, and are in that place and come forward, I have high respect for you. And I know that heaven has respect for you. It's not about what activities you do in church. It's about what is in your heart. Are you totally surrendered? It's about making it to heaven. Have you given up everything? Are you obeying the commandments? Are you taking up your cross? And have you counted the cost? I'm still going to pray, so if you want to be here, please be here now, because I'm still going to pray. And I'm trusting God because he brought this word for more than these people that are here this morning. That he will do some amazing things in the lives of these ones regarding their work with him in this year 2017. That others who could have been here will be jealous of. Please come forward. Thank you, Lord. Please come closer. Thank you, Lord. Give you praise. We give you praise. We give you praise. Thank you, Jesus. Would you like to sing that old song? The song I sang before. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
I have decided to follow Jesus.
Please come forward. I want everybody who is coming to come. Don't stand behind everybody. Don't stand behind everybody. Thank you, Jesus.
I have decided to follow Jesus, no turning back, no turning back.
Heavenly Father, see your children here this morning. This was indeed have your love at heart. They want to do it right. They want to make it to your kingdom at last. And that's the reason why they are here this morning. Lord, I commit them into your hands. You are their Lord and their Master. It is you they want to follow. It's you they want to serve. You do not turn back anyone that comes to you. And so I know you will not turn these ones back. I'm asking, oh God, that for every time of slowing down, every time of slothfulness, every time of, you know, putting their own agenda above yours, every time they have not denied themselves in one way or the other, every time, oh God, that they have not done what you have expected, every time they have made other decisions when your will has clashed with their wills, Lord, we ask for forgiveness in the name of the Lord Jesus. And so I release them into your hands, O God, this afternoon. I ask, O God of heaven, that you will release the power of your spirit upon the lives of these ones and fill them afresh, O God, as they begin to take steps and I begin to walk in you once again. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I stand in a position of authority and I break the power of anything and everything that is holding you back. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, Lord, I ask, O God, that you will touch every aspect of their lives that has actually been a stumbling block, O God, to their walk with you. O Lord, touch it. Whatever it is it job, is it family, is it health? Whatever it is, O God, touch it, O God. Touch it this afternoon. O God of heaven, touch it this afternoon. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and make those departments of their lives good. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, bring forth testimonies, obtain testimonies for yourself in those departments of their lives, O God, so that these ones can be free. Can be free to serve you. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Lord Jesus. Lord, you said in your word. Standing here this morning, that you will grant unto them to be delivered from everything that stands in the position of an enemy in their lives, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, so they might be released to serve you without any fear, without any timidity, oh God, in holiness and in righteousness before you all the days of their lives, in the name of the Lord Jesus. Father, Lord, we give you grace, we give you honor and adoration, we magnify your holy name. Be thou exalted, oh God. Be glorified in their lives, in their circumstances, and in their walk with you. Draw them closer unto yourself, more than ever before. Take them back to that place where they first knew you. And, oh God, take them back to that deep relationship once again. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, Heavenly Father. Bring them under the covering of the blood of Jesus. We ask, oh God, let your blood avail for them. Let your name be glorified. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Do you want to celebrate Jesus as they go back? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you are here this morning and you have not come to him at all, you have not given your life to Jesus, there is a possibility that you have even been going to church, but you know you do not have an intimate, personal, intimate relationship with Jesus. You don't have a relationship at all. I'd like to pray with you. You have not given your life to Jesus. You are not in intimate relationship with him. I'd like to pray with you this morning. Would you kindly raise your hand wherever you're sat, and we'll pray together. Thank you, Jesus. Don't look at who is sitting by your side. This is a personal race. It is a personal race. It's a personal. It's not a husband and wife race. It's not a friend, two friends race. It's not brother and sister race. It's a personal race. It's you and God. And so if you want to give your life to Jesus this morning, raise your hand and I'll pray with you. So it's good to assume that everyone here has given their lives to Jesus. Father, Lord, we thank you. Rise with me, please. We thank you for your children this morning. Lord, we have seen from your word, you said that we should be disciples. You said that we should obey your commandment, loving you with everything. You said that we should take up our cross and continue to follow you. You said, Lord, that we should count the cost and have the attitude of, all I need to do is obey you. It doesn't matter what happens to me. Lord, we are asking this morning, grant unto us, O God, to stay in that place in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, that we will indeed be your disciples and not just people, O God, who are in distant relationship with you, not caring about your kingdom. Help us, O God, to deny ourselves. Help us, O God, to do your will when our will clashes with yours. In the name of the Lord Jesus. Holy Spirit, I ask for a fresh fire upon everyone, O God, standing here this morning. Fresh fire to enable us, O God, to continue this race and to finish it. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, Heavenly Father. I pray for everyone and every member of Grace Chapel this morning, everyone here this morning. I pray that as you go out this week, the Lord will go with you. In the name of the Lord Jesus. The Lord's favor will surround you as with a shield. And everyone that you come across, that you encounter, everyone that you stand before will favor you. In the name of the Lord Jesus. I'm praying that for those lives that where doors have been shut, that the doors will be opened. In the name of the Lord Jesus. And every door that has been opened by the enemy, and every door of destruction will be shut.
Yes.
In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, I'm asking, oh God, that this week your children will be in health. In the name of the Lord Jesus. I ask, oh God, for safety and for security. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. None will beg bread. None will suddenly become homeless. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm asking, oh God, that you will answer the prayers of your children as they dare to pray and speak to you this week. We give you all the praise. We bring everyone under the covering of the blood once again. We ask, oh God, that your blood will avail for us. And we'll be singing victory songs when we meet again next Sunday. Thank you, Heavenly Father. We give you all the praise. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray.
Amen.